Hello, I'm Catherine Nicholson. You're watching Talking Europe on France 24. Now, with us in this programme, someone who's tasked with shepherding one of France's closest and oldest diplomatic relationships. Menna Rawlings became the United Kingdom's ambassador to France back in August. Since then, these European neighbours have butted heads over various issues, from migration to Northern Ireland to fish. They are, of course, still bound together and working together on other international issues, including the COP26 climate summit, as well as being permanent members of the United Nations Security Council. Menna Rawlings, thanks very much for being with us.
Thank you so much, Catherine. It's great to be here.
Just this week, represented the UK at the November 11th armistice ceremony. I see you've got the French cornflower and the British poppy. That's representing right. That. What are your first impressions of the Entente Cordiale?
I think the fact I'm wearing both flowers, as you say, does symbolise the sort of incredibly close history and partnership in our relationship, going back, as you say, to the Entente Cordiale. And for me, it's really important that we take time to remember those ties, to commemorate those whose lives have been lost in the defence of both of our countries. Mm-hmm. Because for me, they are some of the foundation stones of the modern partnership that we have today. I think playing that forward into the 21st century, you're right that there's been some complexities in the relationship, shall we say, in recent years. And I'm really positive about a future path in which we continue to cooperate on the global stage, but also rebuild a really close and vibrant bilateral partnership after our exit from the European Union.
Just in recent days, in fact, irregular migration across the English Channel, or La Manche, as it's known in France, around 1,000 people reached the UK on November 11th. Now, just a few weeks ago, we had the British Home Secretary, Interior Minister Priti Patel, threatening to withdraw over €60 million of funding for French authorities if they didn't stop more crossings. Does that threat still stand?
So, in fact, since our Home Secretary, Priti Patel, spoke about that, more money has actually been disbursed into the French system. The first tranche of that, over £60 million, euros that you've mentioned. And that's happened because we're very conscious of the need to keep working with France on this really difficult issue. And let's be clear, illegal migration doesn't start in France. It starts in countries far away. And we're cooperating with France to try to tackle the flow of illegal migrants into France and then on towards the UK. And in fact, the relationship between the Home Secretary, Priti Patel, and her opposite here, Gérald Darmanin, is very close and very open. Mm. They've got those open channels. And so I think that shows that, you know, behind the headlines, there are often more positive relationships that are apparent. That said, of course, we're really worried about the volume of migrants that made it across the channel. This is a humanitarian emergency. Mm. We have a moral as well as an economic imperative to try to reduce the flow, but more than anything, to tackle the organised immigration crime that lies behind those movements. Mm-hmm. And we're working really closely with France on that, and we'll continue to do so. We're going to have to step up our efforts, clearly, given the numbers that you referenced yesterday, and we're in touch with our French friends about that, you know, as we speak.
I know the embassy very closely involved with the actual officials on the ground who are dealing with this. Just on one specific part of it, France's Europe Minister Clément Beaune told this programme recently, the British government's order to the border authority to turn back boats in the English Channel is probably illegal under maritime law. Is this order still in place?
So we're very clear, we're not going to do anything that is illegal under international law. And I think what you and Minister Beaune were referring to is an indication for the UK authorities that we will, where it's safe and legal to do so, we will look to push back migrant boats back into French waters. And the reason for that is because we want to deter more people from making what's an incredibly dangerous journey. As I said, people have lost their lives in the Channel in recent days. Mm-hmm. And we want to make sure that there's a sufficient deterrence factor in place to avoid future incidents like those we've seen in the last 24 hours. So that tactic still remains a possibility, but it's something that we're very clear will be used in very specific, safe and limited circumstances.
It's just that there have been agencies that deal with refugee issues, migration issues, that say, you know, this could breach international law regarding the right to demand asylum and also put people's lives in more danger. this very busy shipping lane, as we know.
Sure.
Very dangerous shipping
lane.
Well,
that's exactly why we don't want people making the crossing. And unfortunately, they're doing so in huge numbers. So I would just repeat that we won't do anything that is contrary to international law. This has all been looked at very carefully. Now, I understand the NGOs may have a different sort of view and position. And of course, in many ways, you know, they do a fantastic job on the humanitarian side to try to support these people. But we're very clear that our priority is to dissuade people from making that journey in the first place.
Let's move on to another point that affects not just France, but the whole of the EU, relating to the Northern Ireland Protocol part of the Brexit agreement. The British government has said that it's unworkable. Ireland has actually started preparing for Article 16, as it's known to be, triggered to suspend parts of the protocol or the whole thing. In layman terms, that kind of means the UK walking away from these agreements. Now, is this a real threat or is it a negotiating tactic to get more concessions from the EU?
So first of all, it's not a threat. So within the scope of the withdrawal agreement, within Article 16 of the protocol, we have the right actually to suspend unilaterally our participation in that protocol if we think that conditions are sufficiently serious to warrant that. Our position is there needs to be substantive change to the protocol as it stands. It's not working, frankly, in terms of ensuring there's a sort of balanced and stable situation in Northern Ireland, including on the streets of Belfast.
Polls indicate that a majority of people in Northern Ireland like the protocol. They want it to stay.
So I think most people in Northern Ireland want a safe, stable situation in their own country. And obviously, there is an issue of consent for the protocol within the unionist community there in particular. And the disruption that's taken place to the flow of goods from the mainland UK into Northern Ireland has been of massive concern. And we're very clear that we need to rebalance the protocol to make sure it protects the territorial integrity of the whole of the United Kingdom, including Northern Ireland. Where we are with that is that talks continue. So Lord Frost was here last week, and he's continuing discussions with the Commission, who obviously are the sort of, you know, owners on the EU side of the negotiations on this. Those discussions continue. We're very clear there needs to be further change. We're pleased they've been open to discussions on that and that they've put some ideas on the table. Mm. We want more. Discussions continue.
It's obviously the deal that the British Prime Minister Boris Johnson negotiated and signed himself and called excellent. I think it's hard for a lot of people in the EU to understand why he and his government, which you, of course, represent, would at this point say what you're saying, that you're not satisfied.
Yeah. I mean, I think, you know, the world is moving very quickly, right? But in history, it's not unusual for treaties to be negotiated and then to be adjusted as time goes on to reflect the existing realities or emerging realities on the ground. And I think that's what's happened in this case. I think the other thing to say is that since the protocol was negotiated, the Trade and Cooperation Agreement has come into force. Mm. That wasn't existing when we negotiated the protocol. So again, we think there needs to be some adaptation of what was agreed then in order to accommodate the realities of the TCA and where that's left UK-Europe trade more broadly.
Another source of disputes recently, of course, are the fishing row over licences. The UK government omitting to give licences to boats that the French insist really do have the right under the British criteria to have those licences. France still saying we want a rapid solution. Is there any movement on the UK's position?
So again, discussions continue, but I would stress that we see this very much as a technical issue. We're confident that we are applying fairly and reasonably all the provisions of the TCA as they relate to fishing. We want to be reasonable. We are being reasonable.
France,
and we're trying to find solutions.
Talked about some consequences that they could impose, you know, extra checks on goods passing between France and the UK that would cause really significant disruption your embassy would have to deal with. Do you believe that the French would go through with this?
Well, I'm really glad that in the light of the ongoing dialogue that I've referred to on both the Northern Ireland Protocol with the Commission, but also something we discuss with our French partners, but also the ongoing discussions on fish, we've been able to secure a pause, I would say, in any French threats to apply certain sanctions against the UK. Mm. But just to be clear, that isn't something we would want to see implemented. And frankly, you know, I would rather we sort of lowered the rhetoric.
And just on that high level between the French president and Boris Johnson, relations seem to be very poor. For example, after the AUKUS alliance was announced and the Australian submarine deal with France was cancelled, Britain somewhat involved with that, Boris Johnson told Macron to Prenez un grip and Donnez-moi un break, which was seen as not taking this very seriously by people in France. Does the British government really take this relationship as seriously as you say they do?
Absolutely, we take it seriously. And, you know, I would challenge your characterisation of that top-level political relationship as poor. I think there's a very open channel between our Prime Minister and the President of France. They met as recently...
Well, President Macron said a couple of weeks ago, Britain's credibility is on the line, not just for Europeans, but for all of their partners. That's also a strong statement.
It is a strong statement. And I recognise that there are difficulties and there are some challenging issues for them to discuss, absolutely. And occasionally, again, you know, the rhetoric can run a little bit hot, as they say. But behind the scenes, I would only emphasise that discussions do continue. Mm. Our Prime Minister and the French President met in Rome a couple of weeks ago. There's a very open dialogue between their teams ongoing. And I think the spirit in which they approach these issues is to try to find solutions, is to try to move things forward, even when there are problems.
Would it perhaps make your life easier as ambassador if the Prime Minister refrained from saying things like prenez un grip and donnez-moi un break?
Well, you know, the Prime Minister is our Prime Minister. He has a very you know, lively and colourful turn of phrase, which is one of the reasons that makes him so popular in the United Kingdom. And, you know, I think what he works on when he meets Emmanuel Macron is on the basis of mutual respect for an ally, an incredibly close ally, you know, a very similar countries in many ways to the UK with this incredible shared history.
Menna Rawlings, thank you very much for being our guest on Talking Europe.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thanks to you for watching the programme as well. Hope to see you very soon here on France 24.